Hello all, now today we will be discussing a very important topic known as antimicrobial resistance. Okay. Now antimicrobial resistance means now a bacteria or a microbe has become resistant to antimicrobial. Now this antimicrobial resistance is of two type. Okay. Either a bacteria or a microbe is inherently resistant to an antimicrobial, inherent resistance, or it has now acquired the resistance. Earlier it was sensitive, but now the bacteria has acquired this resistance through some means. Okay. Now you must remember that this inherent resistance is not a problem for us. Why? Because if a bacteria is not sensitive to an antimicrobial, we will not use that antimicrobial. We will use some different group of antimicrobial. But remember, this acquired resistance is a very big problem or a big challenge for us, because we are out of options now. We are already having very less options to kill a bacteria. If a bacteria will become resistant with due course of time, we will be out of options. Okay. Now, let's talk about first inherent resistance. Why a bacteria is inherently resistant to an antimicrobial? The classical reason is the bacteria, that antimicrobial is not having a target. There is no target of that antimicrobial which can kill a bacteria. Okay, there is no target. Okay. So let's take an example of certain inherent resistance. Let's first write the examples. You will write penicillin G. Against penicillin G, remember gram-negative bacteria like Enterobacteriaceae family, which comprise of E. coli and various other bacteria, they are inherently resistant to penicillin G. The reason is this penicillin G normally it inhibits the cell wall. And it inhibits one component of a cell wall known as peptidoglycan. Okay, peptidoglycan. Now, what happens in a gram-negative? And this peptidoglycan, remember, is mainly present in gram-positive bacteria. Gram-positive. What happens in gram-negative bacteria like E. coli? This E. coli or gram-negative bacteria, this peptidoglycan is very thin, and it is sandwiched between by a layer of lipopolysaccharides. Okay, lipopolysaccharides are there. Because of this reason, this penicillin cannot act on peptidoglycan cell wall. Okay, because it is protected by lipopolysaccharide, hence the target of penicillin G is not readily available. Penicillin G cannot act against gram-negative bacteria, because peptidoglycan is the main component of gram-positive. In gram-negative, we have lipopolysaccharide as well. Okay, second example you can write is metronidazole. Okay, remember metronidazole, it is not effective against aerobic bacteria. So aerobic bacteria, they are inherently resistant to metronidazole. The reason is metronidazole generally goes inside the bacteria and forms nitric oxide radical, and this nitric oxide radical directly damages DNA. It damages DNA. But what happens in aerobic bacteria? In aerobic bacteria, there is presence of oxygen. This oxygen directly neutralizes this nitric oxide. Okay, aerobic bacteria have oxygen, and this oxygen competes or directly neutralizes this nitric oxide. Hence, metronidazole is not effective against aerobic bacteria. Aerobic bacteria have oxygen in them. The third example you will write is aminoglycosides. Now, you will write that aminoglycosides, they are not effective against anaerobic bacteria now. So, anaerobic bacteria, they are generally, they are inherently resistant to aminoglycoside. The reason is aminoglycoside, if it has to enter into the cell and into a bacteria, it requires the help of a special pump known as oxygen-dependent porin channel. So, it requires the help of a pump, aminoglycoside, oxygen dependent porin. Now this oxygen dependent porin helps aminoglycoside enter into a bacteria, and aminoglycoside will inhibit protein synthesis. Now, oxygen dependent porin is absent in anaerobic bacteria. Because of this reason, aminoglycoside, they cannot enter into anaerobic bacteria. They cannot enter into anaerobic bacteria. And the last example you will write is tetracyclines. Tetracyclines, they are not effective against tuberculosis. TB bacteria is inherently resistant to tetracycline. Okay. So these are the examples of inherent resistance, which is not a big problem because in gram-negative bacteria, we will not use penicillin G. We will use some other class of antibiotic. In aerobic bacteria, we will not use metronidazole. We will rather use aminoglycosides. Okay. So that is not a big problem. What is the big problem we have is acquired resistance. So let's make a heading of acquired resistance. Okay. So in acquired resistance, with course of time, the bacteria has now acquired the resistance. Okay. Acquired resistance. Now remember, resistance in a bacteria is due to a genes. Why resistance occur? Resistance occur due to acquisition of resistant genes. Okay. A bacteria become resistant because a bacteria will acquire a gene. And this acquired gene or resistance gene will form a resistant protein. It will form a resistant protein. Okay. It will form a resistant protein, and this resistant protein will make an antimicrobial. It will cause acquired resistance. Okay. Acquired resistance. Now two question arises. The first question which arises is, how does this resistant protein will confirm resistance to an antimicrobial? Okay. What is the mechanism of resistant protein which can make a bacteria or antimicrobial resistant to, which can make a bacteria or microbe resistant to a drug? And second question arises, how does a bacteria acquire a resistance gene? Okay. How does a microbe or a bacteria acquire resistance gene? Okay. And if this resistance gene is acquired, abnormal protein is formed. This abnormal protein will make a microbe resistance. The first mechanism is how this abnormal protein will make a microbe resistant. So let's talk about the mechanism of resistance. How does this abnormal protein will make a bacteria resistance? Now remember, these proteins inside a bacteria, they will function, they have multiple function. Okay. They have multiple function. The first method of acquiring a resistance, first method by which a protein will confer a resistance, you will write is that these protein, there will be formation of now abnormal structural protein. There will be formation of abnormal structural protein. And this abnormal structural protein will make a drug impermeable. It will make a drug impermeable. So suppose, let's take an example. Suppose this is a bacteria. We know that the cell wall of a bacteria is made up of proteins. Okay. And on this cell wall, there are special channels. These protein channels are known as porins channels. Okay. So these porins channels are the part of structural protein. Through this porin channels, an antimicrobial enters into a bacteria. Okay. It enters into a bacteria. Now, if this bacteria is forming this abnormal type of protein or resistant protein, this abnormal porin channel will not allow this antimicrobial enter into a bacteria. Okay. So it will make a drug impermeable. The classical example of decrease in drug impermeability, which can lead to resistance, is seen in cases of a disease known as trypanosoma. Okay. Trypanosoma brucei. Trypanosoma brucei, remember, it causes a disease known as sleeping sickness. And for this disease, we have made a drugs like pentamidine, and we have made milarsoprol. Okay. Now, in cases of this trypanosoma microbe, it has acquired a resistance by forming an abnormal type of porin channel. Through this abnormal porin channel, this pentamidine and milarsoprol, they will become impermeable, they will not able to enter into this trypanosoma. So this is now a classical example of drug impermeability. The second example you will write is formation of abnormal efflux transporter. Formation of an abnormal efflux transporter protein. Okay. Now, efflux transporter proteins are the special proteins or special pumps which are present on bacteria, which will take this antimicrobial and it will throw out this antimicrobial, remove this antimicrobial out of the cell, efflux it out. Okay. So this is the second mechanism that is known as efflux transporter. The classical example of efflux transporter is seen in cases of, you will write, tetracyclines. Okay, tetracyclines. So tetracyclines, many bacteria have become resistant to tetracycline because of acquisition of an efflux transporter. And the second example you will write, antimalarials. Especially in cases of Plasmodia falciparum. Plasmodium falciparum now has become chloroquine resistant because when chloroquine enters into the Plasmodia falciparum, this chloroquine is effluxed outside. Similarly, other antimalarials, they have also become resistant to Plasmodia. Plasmodia have become resistant to other antimalarial like quinine, mefloquine, etc. So just try to remember the name antimalarials. And tetracycline, the resistance is due to formation of an abnormal efflux transporter. The third example you will write, you know that proteins inside the bacteria, they will function as enzyme. Proteins inside the bacteria, they function as enzymes. Okay, so there is formation of an abnormal enzyme. And this enzyme will cause degradation or lysis of this antimicrobial, enzymatic degradation. Okay, enzymatic degradation. This mechanism is also known as drug destroying. So this drug which has entered into an antimicrobial, it will be destroyed because this bacteria has now synthesized an abnormal type of enzymes. So this enzymes now will degrade this antimicrobial. This antimicrobial will be degraded by this enzyme. The classical example of antimicrobial resistance due to drug destroying is seen in cases of, you'll write the example, A, B and C. A for aminoglycoside, B for beta lactams, and C for chloramphenicol. C for chloramphenicol. Against aminoglycoside, a bacteria forms various types of enzymes like aminoglycoside acetyl transferase. Up against beta lactam, an enzyme is formed known as beta lactamases. Against chloramphenicol, chloramphenicol acetyl transferases enzymes are formed, and these abnormal enzymes, they degrade this antimicrobial which has entered into a bacteria. And the last mechanism is, this bacteria is forming now abnormal target. Okay, abnormal target. Okay, or altered target. Remember, suppose this antimicrobial wants to kill a bacteria. If it wants to kill a bacteria, it should attach to some target. There is a target of an antimicrobial through which an antimicrobial kills a bacteria. This bacteria has started forming this abnormal target through which this antimicrobial cannot bind. So can we say that there is reduced affinity? There is reduced affinity for the target. there is reduced affinity for the main target through which antimicrobial will act. This mechanism is known as the bacteria will become drug tolerant. That means now it can tolerate the drug. This mechanism is known as drug tolerant, and it is classically seen in cases of a bacteria. You will write, it is seen classically in cases of a bacteria known as MRSA. MRSA stands for methicillin resistant staph aureus, because methicillin resistant staph aureus, the bacteria form abnormal penicillin binding protein 2A. Remember, methicillin kills penicillin, it attaches to penicillin binding protein, and this penicillin binding protein now in MRSA bacteria is formed of some different variety to which this methicillin and penicillin cannot attach. Okay, MRSA. Second example you will write is macrolides. Remember, macrolides, they inhibit protein synthesis by binding to 50S ribosome. So this bacteria now has started forming a different type of 50S ribosome. Third, you will write fluoroquinolones. Fluoroquinolones, they inhibit one enzyme which inhibits cell division, that is DNA gyrase. This bacteria has started forming an abnormal type of DNA gyrase. Okay, abnormal type of DNA gyrase. So this is the example of resistance to, due to altered form of drug target to which that antimicrobial cannot bind. Okay, MRSA, macrolides and fluoroquinolone. So this is what will happen if an abnormal protein is formed due to acquisition of some resistant gene. So these are the classical example. Now the second question arises, how does this bacteria or a microbe can acquire this resistant gene, and this resistant gene is forming some different type of protein, and this different type of protein is conferring resistance. So the second question arises, how does a bacteria acquires this resistant gene? Okay, so let's talk about now the second point. How does a bacteria acquires gene? Acquisition of gene, which is also known as gene transfer. How does a bacteria transfer this gene, okay, or acquire this gene? How does this gene transfer can take place? Okay, so how does this bacteria or a microbe will acquire a gene? There are two methods of acquiring this gene. The first mechanism of acquiring a gene is known as vertical transfer or vertical gene transfer. Okay, the second method of acquiring this resistant gene is known as horizontal gene transfer. Okay, second method of acquiring this gene is horizontal gene transfer. Okay, now what do we mean by vertical and horizontal gene transfer? Suppose this is a bacteria. This is a bacteria. Okay, and this bacteria, you know, it has a big circular DNA known as chromosome, and it also has a small circular DNA known as plasmid. Okay, now vertical gene transfer means this bacteria will transfer a gene to vertically. Vertically means to its progeny. It will transfer the gene vertically to its progeny. This is known as vertical gene transfer. So can we say, suppose this is the parent of a parent to offspring transfer. So vertical gene transfer is also known as parent to offspring gene transfer. Okay, parent to offspring gene transfer. So this is known as vertical gene transfer. Okay, now the second one is known as horizontal gene transfer. In horizontal gene transfer, the bacteria will acquire a resistant gene suddenly from inside the bacteria or outside. It will suddenly acquire a gene from some other source. Okay, It will acquire a gene from some other source. That is why it is known as horizontal gene transfer. Okay. Now let's talk about vertical gene transfer. Vertical gene transfer means that these offspring, they will acquire a gene, resistant gene, from its parent or father. Okay. Let's see how it will acquire vertical gene transfer. Now vertical gene transfer is due to, you will write, two mechanism. Either it is due to spontaneous mutation, vertical gene transfer, or it is due to a mechanism known as gene amplification. Okay, spontaneous mutation and gene amplification. Now what do we mean by vertical transfer? Suppose this is a bacteria. With evolution, slowly and slowly, this bacterial gene will become spontaneously mutated. This bacterial gene will become spontaneously mutated, or it will become amplified. Amplified means the number of or the expression of the gene will increase. So because of this reason, either due to spontaneous mutation or amplification of gene, this bacteria will start forming one abnormal protein. Okay, so it is within, it will occur within the bacteria, it will not acquire from any other source. Okay, so spontaneous, so it is a slow evolutionary process, it's a very slow and evolutionary process. Okay, but this horizontal gene transfer, I will be telling you, it is a sudden process. It is a sudden process and it could be very dangerous also, that we will discuss shortly. Okay, so spontaneous mutation will occur with evolution, or the number of gene expression will increase with evolution. Okay, the classical example of spontaneous mutation and gene amplification which can confer a resistance is classically seen in cases of MRSA. So MRSA, which is forming abnormal penicillin binding protein, it has acquired this resistance due to spontaneous mutation. It has acquired resistance due to spontaneous mutation. Okay, spontaneous mutation, it has acquired the resistance. Okay, the classical example of gene amplification is seen is due to amplification of increase in expression of DHFR gene, that is dihydrofolate reductase gene, and it will occur in cases of the drugs which inhibit DHFR enzyme, that is pyrimethamine. So DHFR is dihydrofolate reductase gene amplification. Okay, so it is classically seen with pyrimethamine. Okay, now let's talk about horizontal gene transfer. Okay, classical example, let's talk about horizontal gene transfer. Okay, so horizontal gene transfer is not due to parent to offspring. In horizontal gene transfer, suppose this is a bacteria, it will suddenly acquire a gene. Suppose this is a big chromosome and there is a small plasmid. This bacteria will suddenly acquire a gene, and this gene, it will enter into this plasmid or the chromosome, which will suddenly form abnormal protein. Now this gene which has entered into this chromosome or plasmid, this horizontal gene transfer or this gene can come due to two pathway. Okay, this gene, horizontal gene transfer, can occur within the bacteria it will acquire a gene within the bacteria, or it can occur, it will acquire the gene from outside. Okay, now what do we mean by within the bacteria? Suppose, sir, this is a bacteria, and this bacteria normally, it contains a gene which is known as resistant gene. But these genes generally, they don't express, they are hidden genes. What will happen, that these genes, which are normally hidden, what will happen? They will suddenly jump. They will suddenly jump and they will come to the same DNA or they will enter into plasmid. They can jump between DNA and plasmid. These jumping genes, which can suddenly confer a resistance, are known as transposons. Okay? Transposons. That is why this transposons is also known as mobile, because it is moving gene. Mobile genetic element. Now, if this gene will start expressing, it will come to the active portion of a DNA, this bacteria will suddenly start forming an abnormal protein. Okay? So it is already, transposons are generally, they are suddenly, the bacteria will start forming. It will suddenly jump to the same DNA or a different plasmid. And there are certain genes which are normally, lying inside the cytoplasm. Let's call this gene as gene cassette. Let's call them as gene cassette. This gene, like a cassette in a radio, they can be inserted into a DNA. They can be inserted into a sequence of DNA or a plasmids, big DNA or a plasmid. The area where they will get inserted, let's call this area as where it will get integrated or inserted as integron. Let's call them as integron. So this method in which a gene is mobile, but this gene is not present on DNA, it is floating in cytoplasm, it can be integrated into a segment of DNA. This segment is, this system is also known as gene cassette. Integron system. Okay, gene cassette and integron. Okay, so these are the mobile genetic elements which can be inserted into the main DNA or plasmid of a bacteria, and they will start forming suddenly an abnormal protein, and this abnormal protein can confer a resistance. Okay, abnormal protein will be formed which can confer resistance to a bacteria. Okay, but now the most important part for you and the most significant way of acquiring a resistance is from outside. So this bacteria now will acquire the resistance or this genes from outside. Okay, it can acquire a gene from outside. Now how this bacteria can acquire a gene from outside, it is of three types. Okay, there are three methods by which a bacteria can acquire a gene from outside. The first method is known as conjugation. Second is known as transduction. And the third mechanism is known as transformation. What happens in conjugation? In conjugation, a bacteria will acquire a gene from another bacteria. Okay? So conjugation occurs between two bacteria. Now, how a bacteria will acquire a gene from another bacteria? We know that a bacteria has a small plasmid. Okay? This plasmid of a bacteria can replicate. It will form two plasmid. Now, this plasmid of a bacteria can be transferred to another bacteria. It will create a pore. And this bacteria will also create a pore. Okay? And this plasmid which has been formed, it can be transferred into another bacteria. Okay? So the plasmid which gets transferred to another bacteria is known as episome. So the one of the plasmid which will get transferred into another bacteria is known as episome. And this pore is known as sex pili. It is also known as F factor or F pore. Okay. And this method of acquiring a resistance is known as conjugation. And this conjugation is also known as sexual reproduction in bacteria. It is also known as sexual reproduction in bacteria. Okay, so conjugation. Now this conjugation is a very important mechanism. Why? Because conjugation is the most common method of acquiring a resistance, in a bacteria overall, conjugation. And it is the most dangerous also. Why it is the most dangerous one? Because this plasmid, it contains multiple genes, and because of multiple genes on plasmid, this plasmid can confer suddenly, the bacteria will become multi-drug resistant. It will become resistant to multiple drugs. So that is why plasmid is sometimes known as multi-drug resistance transfer factor. Plasmid is also known as a factor which will confer multi-drug resistant. Okay, the classical example of acquiring a resistance are, you'll write, in our gut there are various commensal bacteria known as coliformis. So coliformis bacteria, they acquire resistance due to conjugation. So they are Enterobacteriaceae family, generally like E. coli, Klebsiella, etc. They acquire resistance. Second mechanism, other examples you can write of conjugation are, you'll write that chloramphenicol. Against chloramphenicol, there is a bacteria now which has become totally resistant, that is typhoid. Typhoid has acquired resistance against chloramphenicol because of a method of conjugation. Okay. Third example, you will write against streptomycin. E. coli has acquired resistance. Okay. And the fourth point you will write against penicillin. Haemophilus influenza has now acquired resistance. So try to remember that this mainly occurs in cases of gram-negative bacteria. It can also occur in gram-positive also, but mainly in gram-negative. Okay, it can occur in both, but most gram-negative bacteria, they become resistant to this. Now the second mechanism is transduction. In transduction, a bacteria will acquire a gene from a virus. It will acquire a gene from a virus. So, okay. So generally, if this virus will enter into this bacteria, okay, this virus is having a resistant gene. This virus is having resistant gene, which this virus has acquired from another bacteria. Now this virus will insert this gene into this bacteria. Okay, so this virus which infects a bacteria, this virus is known as, this type of a virus which infects a bacteria and inserts a gene is known as bacteriophage virus. These type of viruses are known as bacteriophage viruses. Okay, so transduction occurs due to viruses. Conjugation occurs between two bacterias. Transduction occurs between a bacteria and a virus. Okay, the classical example, you will write some strains of Staphylococcus aureus and Streptococcus, they have acquired resistance due to transduction. Okay, some strains of Staphylococcus and Streptococcus, they have acquired resistance due to transduction. Okay, now what happens in transformation? In transformation, there is a bacteria, and this bacteria will directly acquire a gene. It will directly acquire a gene, uptake a gene from environment. It will directly uptake a gene from environment. ओके डायरेक्टली अपटेक फ्रॉम एनवायरमेंट. From where environment the gene has occurred, remember suppose there is a bacteria which died in vicinity of this bacteria, okay? So that gene of a resistant bacteria which has died will be acquired by this bacteria, okay? And remember it is the least significant and least important pathway, least common and least significant pathway, okay? Of acquiring a resistance. So in transformation a bacteria will acquire a resistance directly from uptake of gene. The classical example of acquiring a resistance through transformation, you will write in cases of penicillin. Now penicillin have become resistant to Neisseria species and Pneumococcus species. So Pneumococcus and Neisseria, they have become resistant to penicillin by a mechanism known as transformation. Okay, by a mechanism known as transformation. So this is all about the drug resistance. So thank you very much. Hello all. So now we will discuss a very important topic, that how to select a dose of antimicrobial. Okay, so selection of dosage of antimicrobial. So we have to select the dose of antimicrobial in two scenarios. The first scenario is the dose of antimicrobial or dosage of antimicrobial in microbiology lab. Okay, so when we see the effect of an antimicrobial against a bacteria in lab, then how we will select the dose. And second, the dosage of antimicrobial in patient, okay, when we want to treat it. Okay, so let's discuss about the first part, that is dose of an antimicrobial in a lab. Suppose, okay, so let's see this effect. So what is the effect or the dose of an antimicrobial on bacterial growth, on microbial growth or bacterial growth. Okay, so let's discuss about this first part. Suppose this is an agar plate, okay, and this agar plate, suppose there is a bacterial growth, or you can write there is a broth. In this broth there is bacterial growth. Okay, now in this agar plate or in a broth, you have started adding an antimicrobial. You have started adding an antimicrobial. Okay, suppose you have started adding an antimicrobial and you are gradually increasing the concentration at different. Okay, and what happens after a particular concentration, you will find that there is no visible growth on this agar plate. There is no visible growth on this agar plate. Okay, let's call this concentration of antimicrobial as MIC. Okay, so the first point you will write is MIC. Okay, MIC stands for minimum inhibitory concentration. Okay, so what is the definition of minimum inhibitory concentration? It is that concentration of an antimicrobial, it is the concentration of antimicrobial that will, it is the lowest concentration or that concentration of antimicrobial that will prevent visible growth. Okay, that will prevent visible growth of organism after 24 hours of inoculation. Suppose you have added this antimicrobial and you will see this agar plate or a broth after 24 hours. No visible growth after 24 hours. Let's call this concentration as MIC. But there is one possibility, that if you will see this agar plate under a microscope, there is a possibility of microscopic growth which is missed by your eye. So if there is microscopic growth, increase the dose of an antimicrobial further. And after a certain level, you will find that there is no microscopic growth also. Okay? There is no microscopic growth also. Let's label this concentration as MBC. Okay? Let's label this concentration as MBC. Okay? So let's write the second part, that is MBC. MBC stands for minimum bactericidal concentration. Okay? MBC stands for minimum bactericidal concentration. The definition of minimum bactericidal concentration you will write is, it is the minimum dose of an antimicrobial that kills 99.9% of bacteria or microbes. Okay, that kills 99% of bacteria on a agar plate or a broth after overnight incubation. Okay, on broth dilution, after overnight incubation. So if this bacteria is killed by 99.9%, can we say there will be no microscopic growth? Okay, so 99.9%. Okay, this is MBC. So now the point comes. Now the point comes that the first point you will write, that MIC. MIC, it tells us about the potency of an antimicrobial. Potency of an antimicrobial drug. Okay, so if the MIC of an antimicrobial is very low, can we say that this antimicrobial is more potent? In very low concentration, it can suppress the dose. Or if the MIC of an antimicrobial is very high, that it requires very high dose, the antimicrobial is very less potent. So MIC, what does it tell us about? It tells us about the potency of an antimicrobial. Okay, it tells us about the potency of an antimicrobial. What does MBC tells us about? MBC tells us about whether this antimicrobial is bacteriostatic or this antimicrobial is bactericidal. Okay, so in one word, it will tells us about the killing power. It will tell us about the killing power or efficacy of an antimicrobial. It will tell us about the killing power or efficacy of an antimicrobial, whether an agent will be bacteriostatic or bactericidal. So let's understand, what do we mean by this concept of bacteriostatic and bactericidal agent? Okay, so let's talk about the concept of bacteriostatic versus bactericidal agent. Okay, now bacteriostatic means that will mainly suppress the growth of a bacteria. Okay, so if an agent, and bactericidal means it will completely kill the bacteria, there will be no microscopic growth. So can we say that in bacteriostatic, the MIC and MBC, there is a large difference between MIC and MBC. That means normally, if a agent is a bacteriostatic agent, its MIC, it will suppress the growth, but in very high dose, which could be very toxic, it will completely kill. So generally, this antimicrobial will suppress the growth, it will not completely kill the bacteria. But what happens in cases of bactericidal agent, the MIC and MBC is very near to each other. It is very near to each other. That means if the MIC of bacteria is this and MBC will be very near to each other, that means in somewhat a normal range, it will completely kill the bacteria. If we suddenly little bit increase the dose, it will completely kill the bacteria. Okay, so there is minimum bactericidal concentration. So in bacteriostatic, the MIC and MBC, it has a very huge difference. Complete killing will require very high dose, which could be toxic. While in bactericidal agent, the MIC and MBC are very near to each other. So how we will define them? Remember, we will make a ratio. MBC upon MIC. MBC or MIC. can we say that in bactericidal, MBC and MIC are very near to each other and this ratio should be very small. And if this ratio is less than 4, the drug is considered to be a bactericidal agent. While the difference between MBC and MIC, minimum bactericidal and minimum inhibitory concentration, is very large, the agent will be bacteriostatic. And can we say the difference will be very large? And if an agent is having this ratio of more than 4, then we consider it as a drug to be predominantly of a bacteriostatic agent. It will just suppress the growth, it will not complete kill. So in simple words, to understand, bacteriostatic agent, they will generally suppress the growth. While bactericidal, in simple words, will completely kill a bacteria. Okay? So if a bacteriostatic agent is suppressing the growth, it is not completely killing on a bacteria, then why we are using this bacteriostatic agent in humans, in our patient? Because rest of the bacteria which are left are taken care, are killed by the immunity of our body. Okay? So rest of the bacteria, they are killed by the immunity of our body. Okay? So it will just suppress the growth, which will limit the spread. While rest of the bacteria, they are killed by the immunity of the body. So can we say that bacteriostatic agent, they are dependent on immunity of our body for complete killing. While bactericidal agent, they will cause completely killing, they are immunity independent. They are not dependent upon the immunity of the body. Okay? They are immunity independent. So a question arises. The question arises, which of the following drug would you like to prefer in immunodeficient people? If a patient is immunodeficient, your drug of choice will be bactericidal agents. Okay? So in immunodeficient people, we generally prefer to start bactericidal agents. Okay? Bacteriostatic agents are less preferred or generally not given in immunodeficient people. Okay, so understood this concept. So let's write the examples of various bacteriostatic and bactericidal drugs. Okay, so let's write the complete list of bactericidal and bacteriostatic agent. Okay, bacteriostatic and bactericidal drug. Okay, but before writing the examples, you must note a point that this classification is a very or a over simplistic classification. It is a very simplified classification, but generally in nature it doesn't occur, because one agent, one antimicrobial, can act as a bacteriostatic for one agent, one bacteria, while it can act as a bactericidal for another bacteria. Okay? So it is a very over simplistic classification. So let's write the drugs. So the first point you will write, all cell wall inhibitors. Cell wall inhibitors, all cell wall inhibitors, they are generally bactericidal, like beta lactams, bacitracin. Okay, you will write vancomycin group and phosphomycin. The only bactericidal agent which is bacteriostatic, which is not a cidal, is cycloserine. Okay, so all bacteria cell wall inhibitors, cell wall synthesis inhibitor in a bacteria, are bactericidal. Only cycloserine is bacteriostatic. Okay, let's talk about cell membrane inhibitors. Cell membrane inhibitors are generally bactericidal. None of them will be bacteriostatic. So the examples of cell wall cell membrane inhibitors are daptomycin and polypeptide antibiotics like polymyxin and colistin. They are bactericidal agents. The third example you will write is protein synthesis inhibitor. Okay, so half of the protein synthesis inhibitor are bacteriostatic and half of them are bactericidal. There are only two protein synthesis inhibitor which are bactericidal. You will write A and S. That is aminoglycoside and streptogramins. They are bactericidal agent. While other protein synthesis inhibitor, they are bacteriostatic. Examples are tetracycline and the congener of tetracycline known as tigecycline. Okay, then you will write chloramphenicol okay, macrolides, clindamycin group okay, clindamycin and linezolid okay, linezolid. So one classification you can write that linezolid is bacteriostatic for Staph aureus and Enterobacter, while this linezolid is bactericidal in cases of Streptococcus pneumoniae. So as we have discussed that this classification is a very simplistic classification. Okay, so this linezolid can act as a bacteriostatic as well as bactericidal. Okay, the third point you will write is DNA inhibitors. Okay, the bacteria which will cause bacteriostatic agent is nitrofurantoin. It directly damages DNA. While metronidazole, which also directly damages DNA, is bactericidal. Then we have DNA gyrase inhibitor, that is novobiosin, which is bacteriostatic agent. But fluoroquinolones, which are also DNA gyrase inhibitor, they are bactericidal. Okay, DNA inhibitors. And lastly, you will write the drugs which inhibit certain intermediary metabolism or some metabolic or chemical reaction. Okay. These drugs are generally folic acid inhibitors. All these drugs are bacteriostatic, like sulfonamide. Okay. And two sulfonamide which are used in leprosy like Dapsone and in tuberculosis PAS-PAS, they are also sulfonamide bacteriostatic agent. You'll write pyrimethamine and proguanil. They inhibit dihydrofolate reductase enzyme. And lastly, dihydrofolate reductase inhibitor in a bacteria, trimethoprim. They all are bacteriostatic. But remember, their combination, the combination of sulfonamide with trimethoprim or pyrimethamine, is bactericidal. So let's write a combination known as cotrimoxazole. Because they are acting in same sequence, cotrimoxazole, which is a combination of sulfonamide with trimethoprim, is a bactericidal combination. And if you will combine sulfonamide with pyrimethamine, again it will be a bactericidal combination. And lastly, you will write antitubercular drug. The drug which are used in TB. The drugs which are used in TB, the only drug which are bacteriostatic, you will write electric, pedal, cycle. These drugs are bacteriostatic. The first line drug, ethambutol. It is the only first line drug which is bacteriostatic. Rest all other first line drug are bactericidal, like HRZE, isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide. E for ethambutol, ethambutol we have cut, and S for you will write streptomycin. So which first line drug is bacteriostatic? That is ethambutol. Okay, they are given for new case of TB. Now the drug which are given for MDR TB, multi-drug resistant TB, you will write PAS, paraminosalicylic acid, cycloserine, clofazimine, linezolid and ethionamide. They all are given for MDR-TB, they are bacteriostatic. And MDR-TB, we also give fluoroquinolones, they are bactericidal, and aminoglycosides, they are also bactericidal. Okay, so this is the complete list of the drugs which are bacteriostatic and bactericidal. So this is the information of about the dosage of antimicrobial in microbiology lab. Let's talk about now the rationale or the selection of dose in patient. Okay, selection of dosage of an antimicrobial in patient. How to choose? Now the point is, suppose this is a bacteria, okay, which is hidden somewhere in the patient, which is hidden somewhere in the organ of a patient. This is the bacteria, and we have to kill this bacteria. Okay, now which concentration of antimicrobial or what dose of antimicrobial we should give that should kill this bacteria? This dose is known as, here this dose is known as optimal dose. Okay, here this dose is known as optimal dose. Now what is the definition of optimal dose? Optimal dose is that dose that will kill around 80 to 90% of bacteria in a patient. Okay, that will kill 80 to 90% of the bacteria in a patient. Now the point is, we cannot give this optimal dose. We don't know where this bacteria is hidden, because in patient this bacteria is hidden, and we don't know that what is the optimal dose we should give that should reach this bacteria and kill 80 to 90%. Because in our patient we give the dose of an antimicrobial into blood or in plasma, we give the dose of antimicrobial in blood or plasma, but we don't know that how much of this antimicrobial will reach to this bacteria. We don't know what is the optimal dose. What we are doing, we are giving the dose of antimicrobial in blood, but we don't know that how much dose will reach to the bacteria, because this bacteria is hidden. So the ideal dose should be optimal dose, but we don't know that from this blood how much this antimicrobial will go to the bacteria and how to achieve this optimal dose. That is a very important point. So we cannot determine optimal dose because the bacteria is hidden. Okay, so what dose we should give in our plasma? Let's see how much dose of an antimicrobial we should give in our plasma. Now the point is, we know that in when we are using this antimicrobial in the lab, the minimum dose to suppress the growth of a bacteria was MIC, minimum inhibitory concentration. It was the minimum dose which was suppressing the bacteria when the bacteria was in front of us. But here the bacteria is hidden, so we don't know the optimal dose, but we know the MIC. Okay, MIC is minimum inhibitory concentration. So instead of optimal dose, we take MIC. We will maintain MIC or minimum inhibitory concentration in plasma. We will maintain minimum inhibitory concentration in the plasma. That is the minimum dose which was required in agar plate. So it must be the minimum dose which must be required at least in the patient. But how much extra we should give so that it will achieve the optimal dose? So what we will try to do, we will try to maintain MIC in the plasma. So we will make a graph out here. Let's call this graph as plasma concentration. So we'll make this graph as concentration time graph. Okay, we will make a graph known as concentration time graph in the patient. And what is our main principle? We will maintain MIC in the blood, MIC of an antimicrobial inside the blood. MIC is minimum inhibitory concentration. So can we say that this minimum inhibitory concentration we use in plasma, we cannot determine optimal dose. So this minimum inhibitory concentration act as a surrogate marker. It act as a surrogate marker instead of optimal dose. So instead of optimal dose, we take MIC because we know the MIC of a drug. Okay, so what we will try to do in our patient, in our patient blood, we will maintain MIC. Okay, in our patient we will maintain MIC. This is the concentration of the drug in our patient. Okay, now we want to achieve the optimal dose. So how we can achieve the optimal dose? We have attained MIC. there are certain antimicrobial which will kill 80 to 90% or optimal dose is achieved with certain antimicrobial. If we suddenly increase the dose of antimicrobial very high above MIC, okay? So if we will increase the dose of antimicrobial, let's call this antimicrobial as A. There are certain antimicrobial. If we will increase the concentration of that antimicrobial very high above MIC, they will achieve this optimal dose or they will kill this bacteria 80 to 90%. Okay, very high above MIC. Okay, very high concentration as MIC. So these antimicrobial which in very high dose above MIC will kill a bacteria, these type of antimicrobial, they show concentration dependent killing. This is known as concentration dependent killing or CDK. Okay, so the first point you will write is CDK. CDK stands for concentration dependent killing. It depends upon the maximum concentration, let's call it as Cmax, because this is the concentration, let's call this tip as Cmax. So their killing will depend upon Cmax upon MIC. If this ratio is very high, they will show rapid killing or more killing. Okay, so their killing depends upon Cmax, the maximum concentration above MIC. If this ratio is very high, that means the antimicrobial is showing concentration dependent killing. Okay, now the certain antimicrobial, they will achieve optimal concentration if you will maintain their dose above MIC for very long duration of time. Let's call them as B. If you will maintain their concentration above MIC for very long duration of time, long duration time, can we call them as time dependent killing? Okay, so we call them as time dependent killing. Okay, so this is known as TDK, time dependent killing. It depends upon the total duration of time above MIC and they will show rapid killing. They will show rapid killing. Okay, and there are certain antimicrobial which can show both. There are certain antimicrobial which can show both concentration as well as time dependent. Okay, can we call them as CTDK? CTDK stand for concentration time dependent killing. Okay, concentration time dependent killing, because they can show both of them. So TDK was time dependent killing and CTDK means concentration time dependent killing. It can show both of them. Okay, now if you see this black line, it is looking like a triangle. This is the height and this is the base of a triangle. When you multiply height and base, this is known as area. So CTDK is also known as area dependent killing. Okay, it is known as area dependent killing. So the third point is known as CTDK or area dependent killing. So certain antimicrobial, they can show both. Now the point is how to give this antimicrobial. Okay, how to give this antimicrobial? In cases of CDK, concentration dependent killing, can we say that antimicrobial will kill the bacteria when the concentration is very high? So would you like to give this drug, which is a CDK, in a single high dose or multiple divided dose? If they are killing in very high dose, so the drugs which show concentration dependent killing, remember, they are given once a day. They are given once a day, but in how much dose? In a very high dose. Once a day, high dose. What about time dependent killing? Time dependent killing, they will kill when they will remain above MIC for long duration of time. Hence, these drugs are given in multiple divided dose per day. Okay, while concentration and time dependent killing, they can show both. They can show both. Okay, so they can be given either once a day or they can be given multiple times during a day. But which is more convenient and cheaper for the patient? Once a day divided dose is more convenient and cheaper for the patient. Hence, we will prefer to give them as once a day in a high dose because it will be cheaper and convenient for the patient. Okay. So this is concentration time dependent killing and CTDK. Okay. Now there is a last concept which you have to remember. The last concept you have to remember that we have discussed that when the concentration of an antimicrobial falls below MIC on a agar plate, it will not kill a bacteria. Okay. Below MIC generally, it will not kill a bacteria. Okay. That we know. In an agar plate, if the concentration is below MIC, the antimicrobial will not kill a bacteria on an agar plate. But the case is different in humans or in patient. There are certain antimicrobial which we have given initially, whether it should be concentration or time dependent killing. But if their concentration falls below MIC, they will keep on killing the bacteria. Why there is keep on killing the bacteria? This property, even if their concentration falls below MIC, they will keep on killing the bacteria. This property is known as PAE. PAE stands for post antibiotic effect. So first we will write the definition, and what does it mean? We will discuss that. Post antibiotic effect means it is continuous suppression of growth. Even after concentration falls below MIC, or you will write even after brief exposure to antimicrobial, or you will write after stoppage of antimicrobial. So even if you will stop this antimicrobial, these antimicrobial will keep on killing the bacteria. Now, what could be the reason of post antibiotic effect? The exact mechanism of post antibiotic effect is unknown. But remember, on agar plate, there is no immunity, but in our body, there is immunity. So there are certain antimicrobial that even after brief exposure, they stimulate our body immunity. So if they are stimulating the body immunity, they will keep on killing the bacteria even after they are not available in the body. Okay, so post antibiotic effect means they will keep on killing the bacteria even after stoppage. So let's see the examples of these drugs. Okay, let's see the examples of these drugs. So the first example you will write is concentration dependent killing. Now remember, any drug which shows concentration dependent killing has a very long post antibiotic effect. PAE stands for post antibiotic effect, short form. So any drug which show concentration dependent killing will show long PAE, that even after their stoppage, they will keep on killing the bacteria. Second, you will write CTDK. CTDK was concentration time dependent killing, which was also known as area dependent killing. So again, you are seeing concentration word is coming. So these drugs will also have long post antibiotic effect. That means even after stoppage, they will keep on killing the bacteria. But what happens in time dependent killing? Certain drugs in time dependent killing, they will have long PAE, that is long post antibiotic effect, and some will have no or a very short post antibiotic effect. So some will have post antibiotic effect, some will not have post antibiotic effect. Okay, so let's write the examples of these drugs. So examples of the drugs which show concentration dependent killing with long post antibiotic effect are, you will write SAR. Okay, the first one is streptogramins. Okay, which contains a mixture of two drugs, quinpristine and dalfopristine. You'll write aminoglycoside like streptomycin, okay, amikacin and rifampicin. Okay, Now, how to remember? You know that in tuberculosis, we give streptomycin. We give streptomycin for tuberculosis, rifampicin also in tuberculosis, once a day, but in high dose. Why we give aminoglycoside and rifampicin in TB for once a day for high dose? Because they show concentration dependent killing. That is why they are given once a day high dose. And sometimes in tuberculosis, we give intermittent doses. That we give the dose of a drug 3 times a week, we will skip a dose next day. Because they show post antibiotic effect, because even after stoppage they will show, they will keep on killing the bacteria. Okay, now here you will write concentration and time dependent killing with long post antibiotic effect. Okay, with long PAE, the examples you will write is D FET. Okay, D stand for daptomycin, F for fluoroquinolones like ciprofloxacin, ofloxacin, and a combination of two anti-HIV drug together, that is emtricitabine along with tenofovir. This combination is a synergistic combination. They show concentration dependent killing with post antibiotic effect, their combination. Okay, now time dependent killing with long post antibiotic effect, you will write the drugs are ATT, A for azithromycin, you'll write tetracycline, and one ketolide similar to azithromycin, telithromycin. Okay, telithromycin. Okay, telithromycin. Now, lastly, the drugs which show no post antibiotic effect, the example you will write are, the examples you will write is C, BELT. Okay, C stand for clindamycin. The group known as beta lactam group. Now, beta lactam group, remember it contains 4 drugs, penicillin, cephalosporin, carbapenems and monobactams. That is why beta lactams like penicillins, amoxicillin, when you have sore throat, you take 3 times a day for at least 7 to 14 days. Okay? Why 3 times a day? Because they show time dependent killing, multiple divided dose. Why for 7 to 14 days? Because they should be given for long duration of time. They don't have any post antibiotic effect. While azithromycin is given just for 3 to 5 days because it shows long post antibiotic effect for same URTI. E for erythromycin. That is why erythromycin is given 3 to 4 times a day. Okay. Linezolid. And lastly, teicoplanin. Lastly, teicoplanin. So this is the complete list of the drugs. So the first list is concentration dependent killing with long post antibiotic effect, concentration and time dependent killing with long post antibiotic effect, and time dependent killing with long post antibiotic effect or short or with no post antibiotic effect. So, okay. So this is all about the selection and how to give antimicrobial in a patient. So thank you very much. Hope you enjoyed this lecture.